Welcome! This is Dr. Plague, and today we're going to take a look at the second generation of the homemade Blastoflex video game system and see if there's any life left in it. You're not going to want to miss this, so stick around! Welcome back to part two of my series on homemade video games. So, if you remember from part one, we looked at the original homemade Blastoflex video game system, and we were not able to get that one to work. It was incomplete and didn't have all its parts. The design also was not very good, and it did not appear to have any proper bypass capacitors and stuff. Neither does the newer generation, but it's built on a breadboard, and you can't really make gourmet steak out of burnt hamburger, can you? We're now going to look at this newer generation of the Blastoflex and see if we can get it to work. Unfortunately, this system was only built on a breadboard, so it is likely that some wires have become loose, or parts could be missing, or the breadboard could have bad connections. So this may not be an easy task to get it working. You can see some 9-pin connectors on this system. They were for paddles and joysticks. Here are a couple of paddles that I designed and built. You can see I used some project boxes and potentiometers that I bought at Radio Shack. Remember Radio Shack? It was a great place to get a few parts, although they were quite expensive. The only Radio Shack that I know of today is their online store. There are no stores that I know of near me. So I drilled some holes in the project boxes and installed a potentiometer, a button, and cabling in each, then screwed them together. The Blastoflex also worked with a standard Atari joystick like this one. One of the big differences between this newer generation and the older one is that this new generation does not use a graphics generator chip. Instead, circuitry was built so that it can generate its own composite video signal. You see, the MC6847 used in the first generation was an obsolete chip. This makes them difficult to purchase, and in fact, it was obsolete when we first used it. We bought them from a vendor who just happened to have some left in stock that they wanted to get rid of. The problem is that whenever you use a specialty chip like this one, you never know how long it will be in production before going end of life. So, the newer Blastoflex fixed this problem. The downside is that the new generation will need to generate TV scan lines on the fly and will need very precise timing to do this. This method of generating graphics is similar to how the Atari 2600 worked. The scan lines were basically generated in software. Another difference is that I ditched the Intel 8088 microprocessor and opted for an Atmel ATmega48 microcontroller. They are cheap and still in production, although they are now made by Microchip since they bought Atmel in 2016. One huge difference is the processor speed. Remember that we had the 8088 running at 5 MHz? Well, the Mega48 runs up to 20 MHz. This is a huge difference considering that some instructions on the 8088 can take hundreds of clock cycles, and most of the instructions on the Mega48 only take one or two cycles, with a few taking three or four cycles. So, basically, this new processor will smoke the 8088. Although, we will lose some of that speed due to the need of generating TV scan lines on the fly. One thing to note about this video game system is that it is designed to connect to an old analog TV that accepts an NTSC composite video input. This does not create a digital video signal, but I believe most new TVs still have a composite input for systems such as this. I do still have an old analog TV, and we'll use that when we try this system out. I looked for any documentation I had on this, and couldn't find much. This is what I did find. Some notes on the video timing, some calculations for resistors, but that's about it. I know I used to have a schematic, but I couldn't find it. I do have source code for the games, so I looked that over, and here's the source for my version of Space Invaders. You can see I had the pinout for the processor nicely documented, so that will help a lot when verifying the wiring. There are also some nice comments on memory usage. Actually, I'm quite impressed with all the comments in this code. I had even marked the number of processor cycles used to help with the timing. You can see that this code was written in assembly language, and the big reason for this is that we need very precise timing so that the scan lines are properly generated. If we are off by only one processor cycle, it will be very noticeable in the video quality. And if I ever notice the video is shaky, then I knew there was at least one cycle off. Assembly language gives us precise control over the timing without the need for timer interrupts. If there were any conditional branches, you had to make sure that no matter which route is taken, that the exact same number of processor cycles was executed. This was no easy feat, but I managed to pull it off. If I remember correctly, Space Invaders used up pretty much every last byte of program memory. The Mega 48 processor only has 512 bytes of SRAM and 4K of program memory. And since the instructions are either 16 or 32 bits wide, the most instructions you could have in any program is only 2048. This does not give us a lot to work with. Of course, you can get other processors in this family with more memory, such as the Mega 328, which has 32K of program memory. And you could also look at other processors with even more memory. The Mega 1284 is a good one with 16K of SRAM and 128K of program memory. You can also move outside of the 8-bit realm and use a Cortex processor or something else. The idea behind this system was that each cartridge would contain its own microcontroller since they are so cheap, and all the supporting circuitry to hook up to a TV would be placed into the game console. This was different from the first generation since it contained an EEPROM in its cartridges. Now, I would like to verify this circuit is complete before connecting it to a TV and powering it up, so I very carefully examined it and tried to draw up a schematic. I noticed a few things. First of all, it is missing the crystal and its bypass caps, so I will need to add these. Also, you can notice there are a few wires that are just hanging as little antennas, probably for probing, and I want to make sure these don't short anything out, so I will need to tidy them up. I am going to check to make sure all the power rails are connected and that we have continuity on all the grounds. As you can see, we have a problem with the ground. We are seeing around 200 ohms from one board to another. This will need to be fixed. And I'm just checking power to ground to make sure they aren't shorted or reversed. This ground to ground is showing around 30 ohms, still too high. Next, I'll check power to power, and wow, that's not good either. This is one reason not to trust circuits that are built on a breadboard. They are convenient, but very unreliable. These wires may have become oxidized over the years and need to be cleaned up a bit. So I fiddled around with the wiring and now I am getting some decent results for power and ground. So you can see that I have now added a 20 megahertz crystal and two 10 picofarad bypass capacitors. Now, before powering up the whole board, I'm going to power up the regulator to make sure it is outputting the correct voltage. The regulator is just a simple 7805 and should output 5 volts. I will connect power leads to it and disconnect the output of the regulator before applying power and measuring it. You can see we are getting around 5 volts out of it, and it is receiving around 9 volts. Perfect. Before connecting this to a TV, I want to take a look at the composite video output signal to make sure we are seeing something that resembles a proper video signal. So, I will clip a couple wires to the RCA jack, and then connect a 75 ohm resistor to simulate the 75 ohm input impedance of the TV set. Now, I will connect an oscilloscope probe across the resistor and power this system up. And this is the signal we are getting on the oscilloscope. We are looking for a horizontal scan frequency of about 15,750 Hz. Actually, for color, it's a little less than this, but close enough. You can see each line is about 65 microseconds, which gives us a frequency that is close enough. And you can see the scope is measuring around 15,681 Hz, so I'm good with that. One thing that concerns me is that the signal is looking a little weak, but let's see what this looks like on a TV. Before we do that, let's look at an old photo I have showing the output of the system way back when it was first built as something to compare to. This is Space Invaders, and it looks quite nice for a homemade game system. So, first of all, I'm going to connect up the paddles. The button on the second paddle starts the game, while the first paddle allows you to move the spaceship and fire the missiles. Strange, I know. Now, I'll connect up the video and audio lines. There it is. Now, I'll connect the video and audio to the TV and turn it on. Finally, I'll connect a 9-volt battery to the Blastoflex and let's see what happens. Wow, this does not look good. I was afraid this might happen. Remember I said the signal looked weak? You can barely make out the aliens. I don't know if you can see them, but I can see them and they are green, but they are very faint. This is a problem. We'll have to see if we can do anything about this. So, I took some measurements with an ohmmeter and found a lot of bad connections like we found with the power and ground. I replaced a lot of the wires and cleaned up the connections as much as I could without spending a crazy amount of time on this. Now, let's see if we get any better results. And we do! Much better! Not perfect, but much better! So, this is my version of Space Invaders. Not bad, is it? The sound is a little annoying, but at least it has some. One thing to note is that the scan rate of the TV does not record well with the frame rate of the video camera, so you will notice some irregularities in the video. Now, let's take the Mega 48 processor out and reprogram it with another game. I'm going to show you my version of Nibbler. I'll put the processor in another breadboard that I made up for programming. Then, I'll connect a power supply. Next, I'll plug the programmer into a USB port on a laptop. Then, apply 5 volts to the board. Now, in Atmel Studio, I'll open the device programming window, read the signature, and program the processor with Nibbler. Then I'll put the processor back into the Blastoflex. And here it is. You use a joystick to control a snake. The snake travels around a maze similar to Pac-Man, and there are food pellets that the snake has to eat. The snake's tail grows longer each time it eats a pellet. The goal is to clear all the food pellets on the screen without the snake running into its own tail. You can see that there are different mazes each time a screen is cleared. This adds excitement. It makes you want to clear the screen to see what the next screen looks like. You get a new life every 1,000 points, up to 9 lives. Now, let's take a look at another game I programmed. Unfortunately, this game was designed to run at 8 MHz instead of 20 MHz like the previous two games. I can't find any 8 MHz crystals laying around, so I will need to use the internal RC oscillator in the Mega 48 processor. The internal oscillator is not very stable and has a lot of jitter, so you will notice a lot of wavering in the graphics. I could connect a waveform generator to get more stability, but let's just use the internal oscillator and see how this works. I'll change the fuse setting to the internal 8 MHz RC oscillator. This game is called Brick Blaster. This is very similar to other brick games. You control a paddle at the bottom and hit a ball around with the goal of knocking out all of the bricks. You get an extra ball after every 1,000 points, up to 9 balls. There are 4 possible rows of bricks, and the first row is worth 3 points for each brick, then 5 points for the second row, 10 for the third, and 20 for the fourth row. You can see that there is a different pattern of bricks for each new screen to add excitement. By the way, you can probably see a lot of shadows of the little moving ball, but that is just how the camera is picking up the motion, and you do not see this in real life. For the grand finale, the Blastoflex would not be complete without Blastopong. Again, this game runs at 8 MHz, so it will be wavy. And this is too wavy for me, so let's try using a waveform generator. First, I'll set the processor fuses to use an external clock source. Now, I'll remove the crystal and the capacitor on the processor pin that I'll connect the waveform generator to. Then insert a wire into the clock input and one to the ground, and then connect the leads of the waveform generator. The waveform generator I am using goes up to 10 MHz, but the square wave only goes up to 5 MHz, so I'll use a built-in rectangular waveform which goes up to 10 MHz. The waveform generator is set up for 8 MHz with a 5-volt peak-to-peak rectangular square wave. Then I'll connect the 9-volt battery before activating the waveform generator output. And there we have it, Blastopong! The first person to get to 9 wins! Got one! Ha! Whoa! Hey!
Oh!
You win. So, if anyone is interested in more information on how to design your own game system like the Blastoflex, then please leave some comments. If I get enough interest in this, then I might make some future videos on this subject. These videos take a lot of work to make, so I need to see that people are interested before preparing more instructional videos on this subject. So, if you like this video, be sure to peck at that like button, and don't forget to subscribe, and peck at that notification bell to be notified of all my new videos as they become available. Thank you, and we'll see you next time, right here on Dr. Plague! Let's go play some more games!